Hello, I'm Cara Williams. All over the world, I play pipe organs for a living.
I love it.
I meet great concert organists.
Now, as I meet them, I'd like you to meet them too.
Here's the bench.
And here's me. There's not always a bench. That's a metaphor.
Here we go.
That's stupid. This is kind of fun.
You've really enjoyed the community here.
It's lovely. It's totally different. Yeah. People are very different than Californians.
Yeah. Well, Californians are a breed unto themselves.
Oh, they are.
Yeah. So are New Englanders, I mean.
Yeah. I think, you know, it's a very older world here. It's a bit, it reminds me so much of England because...
Virginia does.
Yeah.
That's
the scenery, the climate, because it's not too extreme here. It doesn't get that cold. It doesn't get that hot. Now and again it gets...
Sure.
But it's a bit like the UK.
Yeah.
And it's old-fashioned, but like old parts of, because I'm from Wales, places like that, which are old, old world, you know, everybody knows everybody, you know. And it's,
for better or for worse.
Yeah, but people take an interest in you. Yeah.
Oh, interesting. Yeah.
That's pretty interesting.
And you just moved here.
About a year ago.
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah. Getting finding our feet. Well, I'm from Europe, so.
Yes, of course.
Being in San Diego for 15 and a bit years, I mean, I really wanted to. Get back, get away and see other organs, you know.
Really?
Lovely organ, but there are other lovely organs.
Of course.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. So we can chat like we're having a cup of coffee and just because.
Yeah.
It is so nice to see you, Katelyn.
Thank you. It's my pleasure to meet you finally.
And thank you for joining us on the bench with Dr. Carol. And let's find out some little secrets.
Oh, yes, all of the secrets.
You have already done so much. I mean, you suddenly, the word to me would be exploded in the organ world. I see your name everywhere, concerts popping up everywhere, and that is wonderful. I mean, it really is wonderful. So you have a love of, I was reading about it, you have a love of a vast collection of organ music from, tell us about that.
I have several centuries of organ music. We're fortunate to have over six centuries of music from which to draw. We have medieval, we have Renaissance, Baroque, classical, all the way up to modern. I was fortunate to study, of course, with James David Christie, whose specialty and real love is for this pre-Bach music, pre-Baroque music. But then I also studied with Olivier Latry. So, of course, we delved into a lot of 19th century French repertoire and some modern repertoire as well, and then I studied in France. So I've really been able to get into some of the breadth of this music and start to get into the heart of a variety. We organists don't like to be bored.
No.
So we do play an instrument with rather a lot of sounds and buttons, so to have the variety of repertoire as well really rounds it out in a way.
It certainly does. I mean, it keeps you interested. Now, do you remember the first time that you heard an organ? What did it do to you?
Actually, I attended church with my parents throughout my whole life, so I never really remember listening to the organ for the first time. I do remember watching the pedals of the church organist.
Yes.
They let me play a hymn once, and I was determined to play the pedals. Little did I know, hymn playing is actually very difficult, especially with the pedals. And, you know, if you already played piano, your left hand wants to follow your feet.
Double up,
so I still managed. I think I doubled.
Yes.
I think I did double, but... for me, it's always been the music. I always say it's always been music. I played piano, I played flute, I was singing constantly, even while mowing the lawns.
Right.
You know, outside I'd have headphones with music, and I'd be singing at the top of my lungs.
That's a vision, actually.
I'm sure my parents loved it.
So what did you? What was your first instrument?
Voice.
Oh.
Without a doubt.
What age was that?
I can't even remember.
You can't remember, but what age did you start doing the piano?
Age 8.
Okay.
Yeah, so I started doing piano because I sat down. My brother was taking lessons, and he's 4 years older than I. Mm-hmm. And he was taking piano lessons, and I was very envious of him. So I sat down and started sight reading. We're still not sure how I...
Even though you hadn't had a lesson?
I had never had a lesson, and I just... It made logical sense to me. I have a slightly scientific brain as well as a musical brain. So going up went going up, and going down went going down. So my parents immediately said, oh, we should probably get her... to a teacher to learn properly, so I immediately began piano lessons.
Yes.
And then picked up the flute a few years later when I was in fifth grade.
Yeah.
So by then I had a couple of different instruments.
And when did you slot onto the organ bench?
The beginning of eighth grade.
All right,
so I was
which
13.
Is how old? Okay.
13. Yes. Okay. I always have to think back, you know.
Yes.
It's now been 12 years since I began.
Wow.
So
you're so young.
We all start at different points on the timeline, right?
So the first organ you actually had, you were let loose on, how big was it? What was it like?
It was an Aeolian Skinner at my parents' church, and it was fairly large. I think it's probably 30 or 40 ranks.
No, it's pretty
and
good
I've
size.
Gone down a couple. I've gone back a few times to experience
it,
and it's amazing the size differences, you know, when you're so small, how large a 30-rank organ feels, and then to come back and realize that you hadn't appreciated the individual sounds. You'd appreciated the size, but not the oboe and not the crumhorn.
Those early instruments do make an impression on you. I remember being locked into Guildford Cathedral with my dad.
Wow.
A big organ, big acoustics, and just enjoyed it, every aspect of it, not just the volume, but you remember those. And then there was a two-manual organ in an army church and in Aldershot, where I spent a lot of my life and early life, and the organ had a glorious, glorious acoustics. It wasn't that big, but it just was like a bell-like sound. And I used to love it. Those early steps are so important. Mm-hmm. You often wonder if you'd had experience with a really lousy instrument, how it would have affected you.
Frankly, many of us start on lousy instruments. We start on instruments that are in terrible repair. We start on Allen Digitals. We start on less idea, even
Kawai
Coles.
But you look around for something better, though, if you're really interested.
You do, or you buy a small Allen for your home, so you can have access to the instrument if your church isn't as generous as some of us are fortunate to have.
Yes.
I had very generous churches around me.
Yes.
But, you know, it's amazing what draws people. Sometimes it's the grandeur. Sometimes it's the size. Sometimes it's the volume.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes it's the variety of sound.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes it's, frankly, just the technical aspect. I get to use my hands and feet to play this instrument.
Yes.
And it stimulates my mind as well as my body at the same time.
Yes.
So it can be a variety.
That's very, very interesting. You've got a scientific approach to it. I was lousy at science, but I had a different sort of... I don't know, just the sheer sound, but the physical. I have a little at home, a very small two-manual tracker, Vita Roland.
Oh, fabulous.
It's tiny.
Yes.
But the feel is just on my fingers. It's like, I guess, making pastry to somebody who really loves doing stuff like that. It feels beautiful.
You're a tactile learner.
Yes.
Yes.
I guess that's why I like animals. I like feeling animals.
Yes.
I love, you know, thinking with them and stuff like that. So when did you know that you were going to be a concert organist?
Oh, I never knew I'd be a concert organist. I remember that my piano teacher was trying to convince me to major in piano in university when I was 15 or 16, and she made me swear during a concert, you know, a studio concert, that I would major in piano, and if I did, she would give me this pen, or, you know, there were always these prizes at the end of the year at the at the recital, so I would get a pen or something like that. But it was always going to be music.
Yeah.
And it didn't matter which instrument.
Really?
In a way, the organ for me is—it's the variety of sounds. It's the total stimulation of everything.
Mm-hmm.
It's the fact that I could play the flute through the organ. I could play the piano in a way. I could be my own orchestra.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, I could drown out an orchestra.
Yes.
I was playing flute in the Cézanne Third Organ Third Symphony, the organ symphony, and I was playing flute and not organ. Ray Cornells was playing the organ. And when those big organ chords came in, I said, well, okay, fine. I guess I'll
just
go
put the flute away.
I'll just do that. That's fine. So that was
so
a bit of a moment.
You've obviously played the Saint-Saëns as well.
I haven't.
No,
not on the organ. No, on the flute, yes. Of all the ironies.
Yeah, I was just thinking about Bruns, who played the violin.
Yes.
That I heard, is that true? Because you specialized a lot in Baroque music, that he would play the violin at the same time he played the organ.
Why
because
not?
Because if you think about some of those scores, it works, doesn't it?
The E minor.
Yes.
There's arpeggiations, of course.
That's
what everybody says.
Yes.
why wouldn't he have?
Yes.
I mean, he was precocious, he was young, and why not combine the instruments you play?
So you went on, you studied with James David Christie.
Yes. Yeah.
He's a great guy.
Oh, he's fabulous.
Wonderful person.
Yeah.
And I often think that people's warm personality comes through their music, and his music is just bubbly, as he is.
It's generous.
He is generous, isn't he? He's cuddly.
Well, that's absolutely. Some of us are born as living teddy bears, and it's personality.
So you then got the Fulbright?
I did, yes. I graduated from Oberlin with double degrees, a Bachelor of Music and a Bachelor of Arts in French, which very much helped me to go to France and start really immersing myself in those instruments.
Yes. What part of France?
I was in Toulouse,
yes,
which is 5.5 hours south by train,
yes,
until they get the TGV up, and it'll be 3 hours. We're very excited for that. But it's beautiful. It has this wonderful Mediterranean-like feel. You take three-hour lunches with multiple courses and glasses of wine, if you like. And I always say that I didn't work at all during that year. I just enjoyed.
Culture. Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. And it's so sunny for 8 months out of the year, coming from Oberlin, Ohio, where the cloud cover descends in November and lifts in April.
Yes.
You know, it's very nice as a contrast.
But where did you study there in Toulouse?
I studied at the Regional Conservatory,
okay,
with Michel Bouvard, uh-huh, and Jan Wim Janssen.
Yes.
And I also took forte piano lessons with Michel Bouvard's wife, Yasko.
Mm-hmm.
So I had to be in Toulouse for essentially 2 hours of lessons per week, and besides that, I could travel.
Were your lessons in French?
Yes, entirely.
Interesting. Would they speak English at all, or was it entirely in French?
It was entirely in French because, of course,
it's easy to you.
It's very comfortable for me. Yes,
really?
French came very easily as a language.
Yes.
For some reason.
You're just very clever.
No, I'm sure you speak more than one language.
My French is... My French is
doesn't
pretty
have to
poor.
Be French.
It's okay, I can get it by. So from Toulouse, did you visit Paris at all?
I did, several times.
Yeah.
I was there for the inauguration of the new organ at the Paris Symphony Center.
Uh-huh.
So that was thrilling to watch,
yes,
these masters.
Yes.
Olivier Attrie played,
yes,
and yes, it was just incredible,
yes,
to listen
now,
to.
Now, where
that
did you have your lessons with Olivier Attrie?
Olivier Attrie I studied with at Oberlin my freshman year.
Oh, okay.
First,
yes,
semester of freshman
yes,
year of undergraduate.
Yes.
That was petrifying.
I remember him coming over, yeah.
Yes, absolutely, in 2010.
Have you played in Paris?
I have played at the American Cathedral in Paris.
I've never been there.
Yeah, it's a beautiful space, and it's,
yes,
well worth visiting,
yes,
whenever you're in town.
Yeah.
They're talking about working on the instrument.
Now,
and
what is the instrument there?
It was originally cavaille école, and it's been worked on because, of course, in Paris there's money. And where there's money, history is not necessarily kind to historical instruments.
Mm.
So instruments get reworked, they get refurbished in the new fashions of the day, whether they be neo-baroque or any of these. So it's been worked with quite a bit. But I believe that they'll be bringing it back to more of an original style or installing a new instrument. I don't know. So
some of the churches don't have money, though, do they?
No.
I mean, because you really sense that with these beautiful instruments,
mm-hmm,
that are pretty much as they were, and it's sad.
Well, the instruments are actually the responsibility of the state in France.
Right.
So the organists are, I believe, municipal employees, but they may not be. I may be confusing it with Germany, but the organs are maintained by the state, so it just depends whether or not the state wants to provide the funds.
It's incredible, isn't it? I mean, those instruments are just iconic, aren't they?
For us.
Yes.
And it's our job to show that to everybody else.
Yes.
You know, it's a part of history.
It is.
That we have to remind people of. I mean, in Germany, they're talking about having organs become UNESCO, which is just thrilling, just to make them, to really give them their historical place.
Yes, yes.
And show them that respect.
So I see that this week you're off to Sweden.
Yes, on Sunday. I fly back on Saturday for church, and then I fly to Sweden after
And you're based
church.
Now in Boston?
I am, yes.
Right. So you've won a lot of competitions recently.
Winning is relative. First, second, and third prizes. Yes, I've been very fortunate.
And that, how's that changed your life?
It's given me connections throughout the world.
Yes.
I mean, the jury members alone, you have ones from Korea, from Japan, from the Netherlands, from France, from the United States, from Canada. You meet these teachers, and you meet these performers and competitors. You're all in the trenches together, so there's nothing that will unite you like being in a competition. And you use Facebook to keep in touch.
Yes.
And you just get these connections of people you can visit,
yes,
possible concerts you can have. It's really quite amazing, the network. The family.
It is, isn't it? Where are you playing in Sweden?
I'm a part of the Gothenburg Festival.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm playing in Gothenburg, I'm playing in Borås. I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing any of these things right. And Mürren.
Mm-hmm.
And then I'm heading over to Wiesbaden in Germany, and then to Bradford, England.
Bradford, England.
Yes, for a friend.
That's different, isn't it?
Yes, absolutely. How better to end a trip to Europe? So I'm very excited.
You're a very busy young lady. Besides all the playing of the organs and all the traveling, do you have a hobby? Is there time for a hobby?
There's always time for a hobby.
And what is it?
I read. Yes. Almost all the time, and I also run.
Yes.
When I can get myself off of the couch, and when it's not cold. Since winter's coming, I'm a little bit...
Well, you really get it cold up in Boston.
We do, yes, but that's when
is
the gym membership...
Is that where the family's from?
My family is from southern Maine, mm-hmm. So they're all thrilled because I'm closer to home than I've been
nice.
In 6 years.
Yes.
Yeah.
So we get a lot of people watching, just a lot of students, mm-hmm. and what would be your advice to somebody who wants to be an organist?
To work on themselves as a person. I mean, as a musician, you're interpreting, you're giving something of yourself to everybody who listens. What can you give to somebody if you don't know who you are? And if you don't have something to give? If you're not living, if you're not also taking time out of the practice room to go outside and enjoy what's going on and other things in life, you can't relate to your audience and you can't bring them something unique from yourself. I would say just work on you as well as the music.
Yeah, you and culture.
Yeah,
the travel
exactly.
is
travel is so important.
It is, isn't it? Because you absorb
yes.
the place, and subconsciously I think you're absorbing that when you play their instruments.
Absolutely. I mean, you're translating
the food,
what you've experienced.
Whatever. Yes.
Yes, and we all, it's so easy to travel now. We have no excuses not to get outside of our comfort zone. And
yes.
to really get to know other cultures. It really helps us to empathize
yes.
and to understand what's going on in the world and to realize that we're all very similar. Music is an international language. It's not
yeah,
a universal language. I hesitate to say universal
yeah.
because you listen to Asian musics, you listen to South
yes.
American music. It's very different. Western music is an international language. But at the same time, it speaks across these borders and it allows us to get to know these other people.
In a good way.
In a very positive
yeah.
way. We share music.
Yes. It's great talking to you.
It's my pleasure.
You're doing so well and I know you're extremely busy. Thank you so much for popping in and chatting with us and we wish you all the very best.
Thank you.
Thank you.